Of two gay nerds in love. I'm Andy.
I'm Archie.
And I guess what we're going to try to do with this first podcast is explain who we are and what gay nerd love means and maybe give you some examples. Is that kind of what we decided to do?
Yes, that's the way we decided we'd start out. Give people, this is more of an introduction, but we will cover some topics, especially what we previewed, Saturday morning with the Crofts. But before we get into that, I just wanted to let the audience know, hello, listener.
Hello.
This podcast is for grown-ups.
Yes.
And there may be explicit language.
Yes. Considering that I'm 49 and Archie is 50, I can say that right. I'm allowed to.
I don't care. Sure.
We're grown-ups, and this is for grown-ups. So we're just letting everybody know that we may have potty mouths.
Might be spicy. Might be peppered with some.
Well, I hope so. I mean, if you say might, you know, I'm gonna make sure that I turn that verb into a definitely will be. But we'll see. We'll play it by ear. But just to get that out of the way.
All right. So, with gay nerd geek, you know, those terms are almost interchangeable, or that's the way they've been used. You know, you look in the online dictionary, there's a definite separation or definition. Of nerd as opposed to geek, that the nerd is a person who actually has an ability and has fascinated by technical things and esoteric.
Okay, and a geek?
Science. A geek is a person, is a fan, basically. A fan and a collector.
Okay.
That's my understanding.
Now, I was going to say, how widespread is this definition? I mean, I know there's the Urban Dictionary, but is there anywhere that this is...
No, I think I found this. It's like on Merriam or something online.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, so someone went to the trouble of finding what a nerd and a geek was. But like in general society, they're interchangeable.
Right.
And for me, I think gay nerd love sounds better than gay geek love.
Yes. Yeah. I think that gay geek love, it's harsher. It's got the g's and it's gay nerd love has the three vowel shift.
And I think it's kind of sexy the way you say gay nerd love.
Yeah, you can
show me some gay nerd love.
Come on, baby, show me some gay nerd love.
So okay.
Yeah. So that's why. So that leads us to the gay part. For those who may not already know, we are both gay.
Yes.
And I guess that's a word we would use because we're old school. We're from the 70s.
And you're like platinum gay, right? You're
all hard to hold. I am platinum gay. I have never kissed a woman romantically. I've never been on a date with a woman. I never had a real girlfriend, if you would, you know, like after the third grade, because I don't think before that counts. I've never had sexual intercourse or sexual relations with a woman, obviously, since I haven't kissed one.
Right. So all those none of the bases apply to you.
No, I'm not even on the playfield. I don't like sports. What can I say? I knew young, I knew early. In fact, I think, as we will probably talk about today, it was pop culture, and it was specifically even some things science fiction-oriented or fantasy-oriented or nerd-oriented that helped me figure out that I was gay or that what I was feeling was gayness or homosexuality, if you want to be clinical, and that I was a member of the
which now, what is that noise you just made?
Okay, we need to specify that too.
That is LGBT.
Archie and I have this great running joke that people always complain about the abbreviation alphabet soup that lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, queer, questioning, intergender, intersex, asexual, ally. Okay, if you've written that all that down, now try to pronounce that as a word.
And did you have to go up at the end? Because pansexual is now added to it.
Pot's
right?
Been added, but I'm kind of worried about popping my peas on our first podcast.
Sure.
So it's and I love that because it kind of sounds like this war cry.
And we're gonna bank that as a sound.
We are totally. So. And we want you, dear listener, to adopt this. We want this to catch on. If anything catches on, I want the pronunciation of the LGBTQIIAAP to catch on as a pronounced word. You know, I am in addition to being into science fiction and sci-fi and fantasy, I'm a linguofag, as a friend of mine used to call it, somebody who really likes language. So yeah
you're a word nerd.
So are you.
Yes.
Right. So that's another reason that we click so well. Which is the other part where we said we were going to go through the term. So we're both gay.
Yes.
And we've pretty much established that we're both nerds, and we'll talk about that in depth throughout right. this podcast.
By the way, I want to interject that I am not platinum gay.
Yes. Let's go back then. So what level are you gay? Are you diamond? Are you bronze?
Actually, I'm not even sure. Oh, gosh, I'd say I'm probably silver.
Okay, that's good. No,
yes,
that's good.
Yes. the only reason I ever had a girlfriend, and it was brief, was okay. because you know, I felt the pressure to conform.
Okay, what age are we talking about?
Teens.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
And even when I was in the military, I felt a little pressure. I went out, this is funny, very short. I asked, when I was in Jacksonville, Florida, the head of the base newspaper, the editor of the base newspaper, I asked her out on the date. It turned out she was a lesbian.
Oh, that's wonderful.
We came out to each other, like, right before our date.
Really?
Yeah.
In person, you mean?
Yeah,
Oh, wow.
She was getting ready. She was getting dressed. She said, let's go to a gay bar. I said, okay.
And that's marvelous.
And the best
You've never told me this story.
Oh, no. We did second base in the front of her car, and that was it. I rubbed her bra under her shirt.
And you did this after you'd already come out to each other?
Yes.
OMG, as the kids say these days. That's wonderful.
Yeah. And that, so,
Was that your last different gender date?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
That's interesting. And just to kind of throw something out there for a future podcast, I would really like to talk about the whole strangely shamed thing about gay men who have had sex with women or who are quote-unquote straight acting
right.
being more attractive than the diamond platinum level gays like me who haven't had that experience.
So that's future.
So something for future reference. Oh.
That's a very deep well.
There is, and we just to mention, we are looking forward to this not just being a one-way conversation where we just kind of tell you what we think. We definitely want you to follow us on Facebook and
Twitter
and Tumblr, and we're just going to throw everything we can out to every possible social media, and we definitely welcome comments. We will be reading them and responding to them, and maybe even having guests. Who knows?
Absolutely. Okay, so. I'm going to play another audio clip that will introduce our next.
Marshall, Will, and Holly on a routine expedition met the greatest dirt play ever known.
Go to a gay bar if you must, and start singing. Just sing. Marshall, Will, and Holly.
People will join in.
Well, see which heads will turn and join in, because it's not people usually in their 20s, but yeah.
No, it's our generation.
Right.
And so that was from Land of the Lost, which is part of a disc, a DVD called Saturday Morning with the Crofts, which was the pilots. For a package of shows that were picked up from Sid and Marty Krofft.
Right. I remember when I happened to see it at the library, and I was always looking for things for us to watch and have fun with, and I looked at this and I went, oh my God, I just know Archie's going to love this. And this is the thing I like about our relationship, is that we've known each other for a year. We haven't been dating for a year, we've known each other for a year.
Right.
But we already have really good calibration. And where we are about pop culture. And I saw this at the library and I went, he is so going to love this. And it's a disc that's not just like, oh, it's a box set or whatever. It's like they decided, oh, why don't we make a DVD set of just the pilot episodes from all the different Sid and Marty Krofft productions. Now, that would be Land of the Lost, Lost Saucer, Wonder Bug, Electro Girl, and
This particular disc was actually H.R. Puffin stuff.
Right.
The Bugaloos.
Right.
Lidsville, Sigmund and the Sea Monsters, Land of the Lost, The Lost Saucer, and Far Out Space Nuts.
Right.
The other shows were part of the Crofts.
Nerd.
The other shows were part of the Crofts Super Show.
Nerd Alert.
And I think that's when they got a few more butts and tried to expand.
Okay.
They started shooting on film.
Right. So I got this disc, and then we watched it together and just... Well, why don't you describe what it was like watching this?
Okay, the experience of watching this disc, for one, I really had not thought about these shows at all. You know, they may have passed through my mind when I'm going to check out a video. What do you call it? DVDs at a local store.
Well, so far as I know, they're not currently. Are they running on TV Land or any place like that?
I wouldn't know that. I don't watch TV Land.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. I don't know of anywhere that they're currently in rotation. They are available in the pop culture universe, and you can go to YouTube and places.
Well, that's interesting because I have no nostalgia for the shows I watched in the 70s. I don't go back and look at them.
Oh, okay.
So when you bought this disc to me, I was like, oh, okay. I wonder if this holds up 30 years
Right,
later,
which is something we're definitely going to be talking about, is that whole difference between just loving something as a kid and then coming back to it 20, 30 years later as a grown-up and going, what did I see in that? Or maybe recognizing, oh, I see now what I saw in that, and now it's a piece of crap from my adult eyes, but I can still watch it and enjoy it kind of through my adult eyes, kind of, you know, reliving it in some ways.
Or like tapping the child, sending you to experience it. But you asked this question earlier when we were talking, making notes for the show. Why did I watch? Why did I watch that?
Right, right. Yeah. I think it's a fair question.
I'm asking you. Why did you
watch it? Oh, you're asking me that question.
I know why I watched.
Well, it's interesting because I remember being really excited about Land of the Lost when I saw what it was, or it was going to be a show or whatever, and I don't know where it was in the cycle, but it wasn't the first Sid and Marty Krofft show, was it? I believe that the Edgar Puffin stuff
was
the
Puffin
first
stuff
show,
was.
Right?
And that's my guess.
I saw that as a kid, but it didn't excite me. I mean, I thought it was kind of goofy and weird looking and fun, and I remember seeing the Bugaloos and loving it because there was this, you know, female drag queen, Martha Ray, as Benita Bizarre, which is a perfect name for her. And she was great and fun and all that. And I also remember being incredibly fascinated with the fact that there was this black guy with a British accent.
Yes, I remember that too.
I just thought, I mean, that was already making part of me tingle, and we can analyze that later. But when we got to Land of the Lost, it was like, oh, Sid and Marty Krofft, the puppet people who make these, you know, wacky TV shows like Lidsville with Charles Nelson Reilly or H.R. Puffin and stuff or those others, is going to do something a little, I don't know if I want to say serious, but that certainly seemed how they wanted it to be taken. It wasn't. It didn't have a laugh track.
No, it did not have a laugh track, and it was the only one, at least in that group, that,
right,
that didn't.
And I know it seems like every child on the earth right now is into dinosaurs, but back then I don't think it was quite so widespread. And I think there was a certain geekier element of kids that was into dinosaurs. So, and then there was the stop motion animation aspect of it. And that was something that I don't believe was in any of the other Sid and Marty Krofft yet. It was not a format they had used. So here they are using this new visual thing that maybe my young eyes had only seen in Jason and the Argonauts, or maybe a couple of Ray Harryhausen classics whatever. Because this was early 70s. This was before Clash of the Titans, the original. And so I remember being excited by that, and I think it may have been one of the first pieces of pop culture or entertainments where I was as fascinated by the format and the making. So I think that, to answer your question, started to pull me in before I'd seen the show.
Sure.
And then when I saw the show, I just thought that Will was so hot.
Oh, right.
For those who don't know, Will is the older brother of the threesome that gets sucked into this other world. That there's Marshall, you know, the father, and there's Will.
Now, did you process it exactly as you thought Will was hot, or did you just knew something you were attracted to
him
at that age?
I don't think did you see when Land of the Lost was on the air? Was it 76 or was it later? Or 74 or
74 sounds closer. No, I don't remember.
Right, okay.
Actually.
Yeah. So if we're gonna do that totally, I think that's about the time I had not yet figured out what was kind of going on.
Right.
I had an idea. But so to answer your question, no, I don't think I'd figured it out. Well, I just didn't know why I was drawn.
I knew I wanted to kiss boys.
Yes.
But older men, I wasn't for well, something. It was like a different.
And what's so even though okay, the actor playing Will was named just Wesley.
Okay.
Which, if you read his IMDb page, you'll notice was kind of one of those things where he decided to go out on a limb. And people have said that probably hurt his career more than helped it, yet by doing something he thought was going to set him apart. But regardless, he was kind of a Greg Brady. He was supposed to be the older teenager. I don't think he was supposed to be a grown-up in the show.
Oh, really?
Right. I think Holly was supposed to be, like, you know, all of 12. And I think, correct me if I'm wrong, someone in the universe out there can. I think Will was supposed to be her older brother, but not a grown-up. I don't think he was supposed to be 18. But
interesting. He seemed older.
He did. Mm-hmm. And we can talk about his acting style in another way, too, because I think that's worthy of close scrutiny. But I didn't see him as a grown-up. Maybe you did. Did you see him as a
grown-up? I saw him as a grown-up.
That's, so that yes. Maybe have been why he wasn't ringing your bell quite so loudly as it was with me?
Could be.
Okay.
You know,
sure.
TV was my babysitter when I was a kid. I thought I watched a lot of television. And
same.
Saturday morning, I mean, Saturday morning was devoted
it
to...
It was our church.
Yeah, the whole Bugs Bunny, you know, so...
Super Friends.
Croft was part of it. And the reason we're spending so much time on Land of the Lost is because, looking back, watching that disc, it was the only, I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, honey, it was the only episode we watched all the way through.
Yes, we need to let people know we did not watch every minute of every pilot.
No.
And I think that's fair. So
yeah.
For those of the before we get deluged with angry mail from fanatics about Bugaloos or fanatics about Far Out Space Nuts,
we're not going to hear about from fanatics from Far Out Space Nuts.
I'm just
Nuts.
Being
I
nice. Sure. I'm being nice. Or Lidsville or whatever.
Right.
We watched the entire Land of the Lost, but I don't think it was the first one we watched because we were watching them in order.
Sure.
And it wasn't. It was the only one that we watched the entire pilot.
Right.
Which I think is kind of interesting. I think we got just enough of a dose of Puffin stuff where we talked about being scared of that flute. That flute was so scary.
Yes.
And the Sigmund and the Sea Monsters, just we were starting to notice something we did not notice as children, and that was that the Sid and Marty Croft puppeteers, almost without exception, did not try to match up with what was being said at all.
I just thought about this yesterday. I was questioning if they're even puppeteers. Because
no.
Really, they bounce their bellies, and that makes
it was like they bought a bunch.
Actuates the mouth.
They're like a bunch of mimes on coke,
yes.
Jumping around in suits. Now, please don't sue me. I'm not saying they were. I'm saying that was the way they appeared to be. It was the 70s. The costumes were weird, and
whenever that flute Freddy got wet, and they wrung him out.
Oh, that's freaking
me out. It was disturbing. It was very
Freudians
disturbing.
Could have a. Field day.
I didn't like that his mouth was always open, you know, because he's a flute, so.
Which makes sense. But yeah.
I don't know. I don't,
the flute was the strangest thing in that show, and I've never met anybody who didn't feel that way about it. I asked you about this when we were talking about it, that was the flute supposed to be disturbing? I don't think so. I think that was an accident.
Supposed to be endearing in some way? I don't know.
Well, who knows?
Charming?
Well, the other thing we mentioned that I want to mention.
Witchy Poo was actually my favorite part of the show. The only reason I watched it.
Just what I was going to say, that in many ways, the wacky, antagonistic character in all the other shows, because there really wasn't a wacky antagonistic character in Land of the Lost because it wasn't a wacky show.
Right. The Magician in Lidsville.
The Magician in Lidsville. Played by Charles Nelson Reilly. Can't get gayer than that.
Benita Bazaar,
a female drag queen, basically.
In the Bugaloos, right.
Right. Witchy Poo, best thing, most watchable thing in that. They were all the best part.
Yes.
And they were all vaguely draggy or campy.
Draggy or campy? And,
or both.
I'm going to go back to campy and maybe gay undercurrent. I don't know. I didn't know that there was a lot, but back to Puff and stuff. And
right.
I just have a couple of more notes about that
okay.
That crazy show. the pilot we saw had Judy the Frog.
Yes.
Judy the Frog was dressed like Liza Minnelli.
Yeah. Yes.
From a Bob Fosse number.
Yes. It's one of those things.
And
where
she talked like Liza Minnelli too.
She really did. And it, there are, I don't know if Vito Russo did this in his book, or maybe somebody could write this book. It may be out there already, or maybe there's a website for it. But it's so fascinating to see these little, look what I can get away with things that the Queens did
right
back before Stonewall, or even right after.
We're not saying Sid and Marty Croft are gay because they did not come out. So
no, this is not an outing show. We're not outing people. What we're talking about are gay pop culture influences where it could have been either intentional or subliminal or unconscious.
Maybe the writers came up with it and they just thought it'd be funny.
Totally. Totally. Or maybe they came up with it and some queen in the costume department said, oh boy, you know.
I'm going to have fun with
this. Am I going to try and make kids gay with this or something. Right. I don't mean that. I just mean, oh, I'm going to go all out. I'm going to make this look and sound like Liza. I'm not just going to throw something together. Because if the one thing we did notice about, and probably why we only watched a little, like, sections of the other pilots, is these were made for a dime.
Oh, they were so cheap.
They were so cheap. And the writing was just weird bad, not weird good. I mean, there were weird good moments, but the writing itself and the plots and, you know, I don't know if it was that at that point, it was before Saturday morning was basically a barrage of long form toy commercials. Now, back then, I think they had the attitude of if it's funny and goofy, just throw it on the TV and the kids will love it. Because we have to do that because of the FCC mandate
and because
of educational television.
Produced inexpensively.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. And there was not a lot of money spent on these things.
And, you know, if you're not watching.
Or they look that way.
As far as shows with puppets, you know, the only other alternative you had was Sesame Street. If you wanted to learn something.
Right.
You just wanted to plug your brain and look at colors and sparkle and glitter.
And in all fairness, I think Sesame Street aimed for professionalness.
It did. Better writing.
Better writing. I mean, they had the whole street set. Big Bird was amazing. Snuffleupagus was amazing. And we can do a whole episode, I think, about Sesame Street and gayness and all of that.
Sure.
But yeah, so H.R. Puffin's stuff, especially the special effects, the really bad chroma key, like with Lidsville, which is all bad chroma key.
Yes.
Tangent.
Yes.
Did we not notice though that they seem to always involve a kind of cute teenage boy? Lidsville had what's his name?
Sigmund had Johnny Whitaker.
Sigmund had Johnny Whitaker. Yes, and H.R. Puffin's stuff had the kid that was like somebody from Oliver, wasn't it?
Jack Wilde. Yeah, he was Artful Dodger.
Right. So it seemed to always be about this young boy.
Yes.
Which I don't know if that attracted us at all because the Will, Holly, and Marshall triangle, it wasn't just about a boy. So there was another departure in Land of the Lost that wasn't true in the other Sid and Marty Croft.
Well, you said I remember you saying that all these shows had the thread about someone wanting to return home.
Yes. That's it, and I almost kind of thought, you know, I wonder if
it's actually Wizard of Oz, really, because
that's what I was just going
to
say.
You escape from your normal world or the world you're used to.
Straight, heteronormative, homophobic, or just, you know, when you don't know those bell hooks level terms, when you aren't doing your master's thesis and you're just a 12-year-old kid growing up in Lewiston, Idaho, like I was, or a 10-year-old kid, or even in a city. Back when we were growing up, I hate using that phrase. I'm using it as a little.
Why does it make you sound old?
I don't care about being old. I'm very, very pleased that I'm 49 years old. But I think people tend to use it as a parenthesis. To say, you're going to talk about what it was like and how it was much better or not better.
Back in my day.
No, I think in this case, I should say back in the 1970s.
Sure.
Being gay was very different than it was in the 80s or especially now. I mean, there were no gay straight student alliances.
I got beaten up and called names.
Right. I left the public school system in the eighth grade because I was being harassed for being gay. There was no It Gets Better. This is Lewiston, Idaho, population 28,000 people. And Sacagawea Junior High School was no safe place for LGBTQ.
I should say it was late 70s and early 80s, but being a transfer kid, I was always the new kid.
Right.
And being, I was always already introverted for not being athletic and being gay, and then also being into nerdy things, you know, like making, reproducing special effects that I had seen, right, and trying to make them on the cheap. And I used to, I did write very short narratives. I tried to get cute boys involved in my projects. Why not?
I used your filmmaking skills recruitment. Oh my goodness.
I never kissed any of them, darn it.
But you wanted to.
But I got them involved.
You could have written it. You would have wanted to write a script about it.
Snuck onto the lot of Universal Studios. We'll talk about that later.
Oh, that's an episode.
Yes, an episode. But back to Land of the Lost. I think
let me use that transition that you were starting to talk about, is that if we go all the way back and say that the stem cell of the gay American child.
But we're back in the
70s. Okay. No, I'm talking about Wizard of Oz.
Oh, the third.
Now,
okay.
Now, I don't think that it was planted in 1939. And I don't think that anybody making the Wizard of Oz was thinking, oh, I'll bet gay boys or whatever are going to vitalize Julie Garland someday or whatever. I don't think that was intentional at all in any of the making of it. In fact, I think the now stereotypical, but I think rooted in reality, association of gay man with Judy Garland and all of that goes back to the fact that that movie was only shown once a year. There was no VCR. There was no DVR. There was no video cassette recorder or any way to get it. And it was only re-released to theaters like a couple times, I believe, because it had flopped back in 1939. It was being shown on television once a year as a kind of way to try and recoup money. And so the generation before ours related to it as a kind of event. And I think the fact that it was an event, all the kids would cluster around the TV and watch it then. And that means all the little gay boys were out there clustering around on the TV. So it had a kind of focused holiness of pop culture then. And I believe, and what I want to ask about, and what I think we were going to talk about, was in the next generations, of which you and I are going to kind of, we're both Gen X.
Right.
We grew up in a period after Stonewall, though we were born before Stonewall, and there was already gay liberation stuff going on before Stonewall. Let me just say that it's kind of tired that people continue to act like there was nothing gay happening until the Stonewall riot, and that's not true. There were marches at the White House in 64. But I think that we grew up in a time when gayness was starting to creep into the culture, but not clearly at all. There were coded things. But the question I have is, because we grew up in that era and we couldn't turn on Will and Grace, or we couldn't go watch something that was kind of specifically, oh, that's like Ugly Betty. I bet every gay boy of that generation, of that particular kind of gayness, tuned into that in the aughts, I think that's when it was on the air. But we didn't have that. And I wonder, the question I have is, I know we were drawn to Sid and Marty Cropper. We were drawn to Land of the Lost because of the animation. Mm-hmm. And we were drawn, to a certain extent, to science fiction because of fantasy elements or because of fantastic elements, because kids like fantasy or whatever. But the question I'm posing, this is not rhetorical, is, was there an accelerated or greater interest among gay men, lesbians, whatever, sexual minorities, before they had even figured out that they themselves were sexual minorities, that they were drawn to this idea or to this matrix of another land, of another place, or of being stranded in another place that they had to get back from? And look at Sid and Marty Croft.
Sid and Marty Croft or people involved in the creation of those shows tapped into that very thing.
Yes, every
show.
The
Wizard of Oz model.
Right. It was like they took the Wizard of Oz model with a thousandth of the budget and not the writing crew, and the songs were, well, you know.
Yes.
We can not talk about that.
Although I know the Puffin Sex song by heart.
Everybody does. But what was strange was, and I think it's important you point out that they started with Wizard of Oz, is it is the same matrix in the sense of the child, let's just call him the child, mm-hmm. is pulled away or drawn out from his normal existence to a place that is fantastical and fun, even though there's danger from the Witch of the West, from the Charles Nelson Reilly character, mm-hmm. from Witchy Poo, from Bonita Bazaar, whatever. Although there's nobody in Bugaloos that visits from the outside world. That's the one show where that's not true. So we'll just pass that one by. But all the others, it's kind of like somebody gets pulled out of their domain, and they end up in this wacky, wonderful world of costumes and special effects.
Meet these wild characters. Some are friends.
But all they want to do is get back. Mm-hmm. But there's kind of this having it both ways where it's like, well, while they're here, we'll make this wacky TV show about it, and kids will tune in. And so there was this kind of strange dichotomy, almost oxymoron, of I'm here in Lewiston, Idaho, this little kid that feels different in a way I don't understand from everyone around me, and I'm starting to get teased for it, and they're calling me sissy or whatever, and I'm not fighting back because there's something in me that says, yeah, that's probably true. So I'm drawn to this idea of escape. I'm drawn to this idea of there being an outside world that's more colorful, more magical, more fun, but that's also dangerous because there is a safety about home and familiarity. So I'm wondering if, and I've noticed this when people talk about Star Trek, that there's this huge fan base of Star Trek that's very gay. Yes. And I think that's probably true. I don't know if anyone's done research.
Well, because,
I hope someone has.
Because Starfleet, I mean, it's presented as an inclusive society.
Right. But I'm wondering in general, if you zoom out, has anyone done a search to see, is interest in science fiction / fantasy greater in the LGBT population than in the general heteronormative or whatever in the so-called mainstream culture? I wonder if anybody's collected any kind of numbers on that, because I'm just wondering if that. I think there's a sociological thing to be studied here about gay nerds,
right?
And that's of course something we're going to be talking a lot about.
That's a lot about. So the reason we one second. So yes, Land of the Lost was the only one we finished.
True.
We're naked, by the way.
Oh, yeah, you know, we didn't mention that, but we're actually doing the first podcast naked. So in terms of true gay nerd lovers, we are, I don't know if that gives us extra credibility. I think it should. But anyway, tangent.
Anyway, I just want to
tangent.
Say that. Tangent. So breezing through the others, and I'm hesitant to say that there was a cynicism in how cheaply cheap the shows were. And
yes, definitely.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know if it's a cynicism or laziness.
That's a better word. There was a laziness. It's like, kids will watch it.
Yeah, I don't think they meant to be cruel.
We'll just throw some color and some glitter,
right,
and they'll watch it. You know, and some
right. Well, now, didn't you tell me that there was, because I think I asked you this earlier this week, is how much merch was generated by Sid and Marty Krofft? We don't know. We haven't.
I don't know,
but
we did find out online that the park they tried to open, and you can research this.
Theme park listener.
Yes, a Sid and Marty Krofft themed park didn't last a year.
And when you told me that, I'm thinking, oh, the grown-up me would have died to see what that was really like. Because it was probably
I wish there was video. There's no YouTube video of it, really.
Yes, it's almost like I want web spiders to crawl the web and find any footage.
Someone's
any
home
video. Well, now, what
anything.
Year was it that it happened
please
to
don't
crash?
Ask me that, because I didn't
okay,
remember.
Well, we can find that
I don't
out
have
later.
That note.
We'll put that on the web page as soon as we figure it out. But it must have been about the time it was at its peak, which probably was mid-70s, late 70s.
Sure. And so I think that points to maybe the narrow, I won't say cynical, but laziness, the narrow bandwidth that those shows have.
Right.
Because I think I'm pretty sure I stopped watching them when I was maybe 16.
There's a window there.
Earlier
and I think,
than that.
And I think I also want to make a kind of counter comment.
Because they were terrible.
Well, they were terrible, but they were not, I would argue.
Yes.
That they were not as terrible as the He-Man Masters of the Universe cartoon toy commercials that clogged the airwaves on the 80s. That, to me, is far more cynical. Because those were just, let's take this toy and find a delivery device to get the kid to want the toy.
Sure.
And the animation there was crap. And
yes,
the stories were
crap. Hanna-Barbera level.
And there was much far less imagination. So
No slight on Hanna-Barbera.
Not at all. But I'm saying that not specific to any studio, there was this trend in the 80s that was cynical, that was consciously saying, let's just churn out stuff that's going to sell product instead of H.R. Puffin stuff. For the crap budgets they may have thrown at this, there still was some sort of attempt to do something just completely bizarre. I mean,
yes.
Lidsville is the most surrealistic thing I think has ever been produced for children.
It's like a drug dream.
It is like a drug dream. Everyone snickers about the fact that it's called Lidsville. And you had Charles Nelson Reilly in this bizarre clown-like makeup in high flame queen mode. You know, I mean, they could have simply cast a woman. He's just screaming. But I would say that I would prefer, I would not go back. I never even watched the commercials that I'm talking about. And when I say commercials, I'm talking about actual shows that just seemed like commercials because all they were really trying to do was getting you to buy the action figure, quote unquote.
Right.
I didn't even watch those, but I would not rewatch them either now. But I would, like we did, go back and watch these. Which brings me to the question that we were also asking ourselves when we were kind of doing the pre-show organization. Why do people go back and watch this stuff now? I don't believe that DVD was put out to set kids in front of the television like they do with Finding Nemo.
Well, Rhino puts out everything.
They do. Rhino and Shout Factory. God bless them. We are not getting paid any promotional money at this point. We're doing this all on our own. It is, in my opinion, Shout Factory is one of the best things to happen to the preservation of pop culture appreciation.
The archiving pop culture.
As well as just really campy bad stuff that otherwise probably wouldn't get marketed. I would love to have sat in the back of the room when they were deciding to put this disc together and how they were going to market it, because I don't think this was being marketed at the people who were the age group that was targeted at the original show. I think this was something like the way Planet of the Apes figures are sold to 30-year-old men now.
Right. It's what nostalgia marketing, what did you call it? Something like that?
I refer to it as gaystalgia.
And
I say that not because anybody who likes this is going to be gay, because that's not true. There's probably lots of straight men, and we want straight male listeners out there too.
Sure.
And we appreciate them. We love them. That they were, you know, as excited by Land of the Lost and the dinosaurs as that. But now, I don't think they would necessarily go back and watch it with the same kind of zeal that we watched that whole disc.
No.
Well, not the whole disc, but pieces of each show and just laughed and had fun.
Well, because now we can see them in, you know, with a different eye.
Well, that's what I'm going to say. That's what I want to say is when I talk about gaystalgia for me is that kind of slightly bittersweet, campy giggle that you get when you think, oh God, I was this little gay boy or this little dyke in middle America or even in a big city, whatever, but I felt all alone and this was my island of fantasy and my island of fun or whatever, and this was my escape over the rainbow, whatever. And that's so coming back to that, gaystalgia is when you revisit that. You revisit that pain, because nostalgia, the word nostalgia, means pain from an old wound.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't mean something giddy. The original meaning of the word was a kind of sadness, a kind of melancholy.
A longing for something that was.
Or that's gone. And I think that as much as gay people are stereotyped as being obsessed with their youth, there's probably kernels of truth in that, in the sense of there was an innocence before we discovered we were hated. And as I point out to some people, when we're talking about minorities in general, across the spectrum, whether it's, you know, Black, Latino, Protestant, Catholic, communist, whatever, I usually chime in and just ask them a question and say, how many of those minorities were born behind enemy lines? because only people are born into a family. Well, not all of them. I would say now there are more and more gay and lesbians with kids. But back when we were growing up, there were almost no kids growing up in queer families or even queer-friendly families. So we start life aware that we're different and not even knowing why, and knowing that we're surrounded by people who are different from us and not knowing why. That's a very unique mental emotional matrix. And that's why I think there's a special kind of gaystalgia rather than just nostalgia that often is triggered by pop culture, by especially, you know, TV shows we watched when we were kids, shows we listened to, models we played with, music we listened to.
Yes.
Okay.
I wish those shows were better.
Right. Sure.
And Land of the Lost, I think, I mean, I know from observation, even though the movie didn't do well,
the Will Ferrell movie.
They were aware that it was, for what it was, above all the other cross products.
Right. It's significant that there was an H.R. Puffin Stuff movie back in the day when H.R. Puffin Stuff was on the air. In fact, Mama Cass has a musical number in it.
Oh, I know. She played
a
witch.
I highly recommend going to YouTube. Maybe we'll put that link up. Mm-hmm. It's hilarious.
It's a witch's convention.
Correct. But no, there have not been, in and among all the terrible reboots, Bewitched, Stepford Wives, all the things that seem to have been kind of recycled, the only property of the Sid and Marty Krofft universe that I'm aware of that got any kind of resurrection, much less a full big budget Hollywood movie, was Land of the Lost. And I wonder why that was. Just that they think it had the broadest appeal or the least camp? Or
I think the least camp and the broadest appeal.
Yeah.
Because we talked about the idea of them falling off a cliff into and traveling through time by falling off a waterfall is ridiculous. But once they're there, the possibility of you know, being in, you know, dinosaurs did exist.
Right.
And not at the same time as people.
No.
But now,
unless you're the creationist and you believe that Jesus Christ rode around on a dinosaur, let's just explain that no, we do not believe that's true, but go ahead.
And the and then they introduced like the Slee Stacks and Chaka, Sadisa Taka, whatever, and the big styrofoam strawberries and all that. And they went from the hand puppet and so it had a lot. There's a lot involved in that show. The hand puppet and
it was a departure.
The same shots.
It was a departure from their usual
goofy
Matrix singing and dancing, laugh-tracked variety show. That there was an empiricism about that, you know. That so it's interesting that I have not watched the Will Ferrell.
I haven't seen it either.
And I was originally going to not see it, mm-hmm. but now that we've done like so much exploration and so much interest in this, I'm actually going to think, you know what? I want to see if, because the fact that they cast Will Ferrell makes me wonder, okay, then they must have been going for some kind of camp value here, because I don't think it's supposed to be like Jurassic Park. It's supposed to be something kind of funny.
But Will Ferrell was also in Bewitched.
Correct. And it's so sad that the only thing watchable in that movie is Steve Carell's brief scene as Uncle Arthur, but
I have to see that.
We'll
one
talk
too.
About that right. later after you've seen it. Then we can talk about it on our future podcast. But yeah, I think that is significant to point out the realism of the Land of the Lost, if you will, compared to all the other, you know, Sid and Marty Krofft offerings. And maybe that's why it's stuck with us.
All hands abandon ship.
Do that again.
All hands abandon ship.
Okay, I just want you all to know that one of the things, and the list is so long, one of the things I love about Archie is he is such a good impressionist and mimic, and he can do not only the voices, but do the right tones.
Reasonable.
And the right...
That was supposed to be Patrick Stewart, Captain Picard on the Starship Enterprise, TNG.
In what episode?
Oh, damn you. Yesterday's Enterprise.
Yesterday's Enterprise. No, it's not Yesterday's
yes,
Enterprise.
Yes, it is, isn't it?
No, it's Cause and Effect. Yesterday's Enterprise is not the one where the ship comes through and keeps
it's
destroying
the one,
them.
It's the one they explode and they
it's
keep
the
going.
Groundhog Day episode.
It's the Groundhog Day when Data doesn't
when they keep blowing up. Yes, it's when they keep blowing up.
That's right. I got excited. Okay. But I love... That's the nerd red alert. We'll sound bank that
alert.
Too, but... All hands abandon ship!
Yes, that means I know what that means. That's going to be our signal for when we kind of want to wrap things up. So,
thank you very much for listening.
Yeah, someday you can say, you know, I heard the first podcast of Gay Nerd Love back when nobody knew about it, right?
So new, just a little housekeeping, new episodes will be available weekly on Mondays. In the meantime, stay connected to us by going to gaynerdlove.com. That's our Facebook page for now.
For now.
And leave your comments and questions. And see links to where you can also find Gay Nerd Love online, like our Twitter, at Gay Nerd Love.
Yes. And what's our Tumblr? Gay, is it the one that's gay-nerd-love? I don't think so.
I don't have that.
The links for all of the other social network nodes are at our Facebook page. And, of course, we'll be on the webpage when it goes live as well. Do you have any idea about when that's going to happen, or do you know?
The webpage?
The webpage itself.
I don't have an app.
Okay. That, and I don't know is always a perfectly good answer.
I don't know.
But yes, so, we want this to be a conversation with you as well.
So during the week between episodes, we'll post links and images to what we find interesting and fun.
And reposting
things.
If you post something interesting and you're following us and we follow you and you're in our Twitter feed, we'll say, hey, this, you know, so-and-so at so-and-so found this hilarious, you know, blooper reel from The Next Generation, or found this new thing we'd completely forgotten about, or some funny gif from Thunderbirds or whatever. We'll be happy to retweet it and post it up on the web.
So we'll see you next time.
Yes, we will.